thanks guys for all the work you put in terms of producing the hazard reports. Having gone through them all, what I don't intend to do is go through each and every one on an individual basis, but I've looked at them and I'll summarise the majority of the main findings from your submissions, and I'll just provide a little bit of clarity on the way forward. Bear in mind that a lot of your recommendations are valid and we are moving forward with them. Some of the recommendations, there might be a little bit of a conflict there in terms of what your industry standards are, and then trying to cross-reference them with the UK standard. And in the vast majority of cases, your industrial standards may be far superior to what the minimum standards are required in industry. But that's no excuse, because at the end of the day, we need to continuously improve our safety performance. And if in order for us to do that, the reliance is on regular workplace inspections, acting upon reports, so that we can understand better the specific risks that are posed to course delegates and other people who use our facilities. Okay, so in no particular order, a couple of the observations that we picked up. In terms of ladders, i.e. there's no fall prevention on the top of some of the ladders, i.e. there's no gates as such. The ladders in question are infrequently used. Okay, however, we are moving forward, and our intention is to put a gate on the top of the two ladders in question. Okay, so that's been sized up, and hopefully we'll be able to buy one off the shelf and get them fitted retrospectively. Okay. Chemical storage. As you are hopefully well aware, that the area where two chemical plants were, and that general area, was being tidied up, and the floor was in the process of being painted. So as a direct result, a lot of items of equipment, including the existing chemical storage bags and pallets, were just moved to one side, and in that process some of them were damaged. We have now identified an area they are going to go, and they will be put in a metal cage with secure and controlled access. Obviously the spillages have been subsequently cleaned up, so the areas are now marked, and that will happen. We're just waiting for the cage to be delivered so we can go ahead and fit that. Waste segregation. Whilst we have different waste streams, and we do segregate the vast majority of waste on site, i.e. we separate metals, chemicals, cardboard, paper from general waste, in terms of recycling, a lot of the recycling, it goes into a mixed recycling bin, and it's sifted and sorted at the recycling depot. So cardboard, paper, plastics, metals, etc., drinks cans, all goes in the same bin on site, and then it's processed off site. So generally what we have in the workshop is a general waste bin and scrap metal receptacles. Anything other than that should be transferred outside and disposed of in the appropriate external waste bins. So hopefully that resolves that. In terms of manual handling, the shelving that is within the hand tools area that is there for the pumps, valves, fixtures and fittings, etc., etc., for use in that area. Yes, you're quite right in identifying that the larger item should be at either the mid-torso range or lower to the floor, and the lighter item should be at chest stroke shoulder height. And we are in the process of changing that and moving that around so it reduces the manual handling risk in that area. PPE. Having looked at the issue around some learners not wearing PPE in accordance with the signage that was displayed, it would appear that the signage in question had been left after we had removed a drill from that particular area. So there was no requirement for PPE to be worn, or there should have been no requirement for PPE to be worn in that area. It's just that inadvertently, once we removed the equipment, we hadn't moved the signage, but that's since been corrected. First aid provision. We have adequate provision on site, and there is a first aid risk assessment that assesses our first aid needs. Our decision is largely based on risk, and currently our decision is that we will have the first aid kits within the medical room, which are all accessible by the first aid personnel, and there are signs and pictures around the site. Hopefully it's quite easy to identify who the individuals are. In isolated locations, i.e. in separate buildings which are a considerable distance away from the medical room, there will be separate first aid equipment provided, and those are regularly checked. We don't generally keep them in the work areas because then they are prone to unauthorised use and access by learners, staff, etc, etc. So we like to keep control over them. In answer to one of the questions about if an injured person was significantly injured or seriously injured, how do you get him to the medical room? We'd treat them at the scene, and if necessary the paramedics will be called on site and they will be treated at the scene rather than inadvertently trying to get them to our medical room. And whilst we haven't demonstrated that in terms of injuries, we've demonstrated that in terms of medical conditions that do occur, and people fainting, passing out, etc. in lecture rooms and other areas. Emergency eyewash stations, it was identified that a number were missing or out of date. They have been since corrected and replenished. The emergency shower in the Pratt's plant was isolated as a direct result of the floor being painted. That's been reinstated now, and that's going to get retested accordingly. Okay. Lifting equipment, that has since been re-inspected, and hopefully now all the colour coding is of the relevant colour, and the indicating panels are hopefully now the correct colour that will indicate what the relevant coding is for that, or the relevant colour is for this particular moment in time. The portable appliance issue, i.e. there was a piece of kit that was identified and not being in dirt, that's been since removed and put into quarantine. And the induction issue has been since resolved, i.e. you've all been issued now with the induction information and a map of the site. Any questions or comments on anything at the moment? Largely, what I'd like to say, just to close it, is largely we are required to conduct risk assessments, and we are required to ensure that our controls remain effective. Okay. We use the approved code of practice and the HSE guidance material that's available in the UK to give us guidance. And largely our decisions are based on industry practice, best industry practice or best practice. Okay. As I said earlier, there's always room for improvement, so once again, thank you for your input. I feel confident that the vast majority have been corrected, or if not, is in the process of being corrected, i.e. we're just waiting for delivery of items of equipment so that they can be implemented. But at the moment, okay, things are moving, and again, once again, thank you for your input.